Good afternoon. Can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus, and I ask members to take care and observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. Please only use the aisles for accessing your seat or for moving around the Chamber. The first item of business is portfolio questions. The first portfolio is net zero, energy and transport. If a member wants to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or put an R in the chat function if they are joining us online, and that should be done during the relevant question. Can I also please ask those asking questions to be succinct with their questions, and to the ministerial team to do likewise with their responses. And first up, can I call question one, Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to provide support with the phasing out of gas-fired boilers in homes.
Cabinet Secretary.
At least 1 million homes and 50,000 non-domestic buildings will need to change to zero-emission heating systems by 2030 to help meet our climate change targets. The Scottish Government runs a number of advice and funding schemes to help homes and businesses make the transition to zero-emission heat. For example, households can access up to £13,000 cash back per home for zero-emission heating and energy efficiency measures, and we are extending this scheme until at least 2023. We've increased our overall investment in our heat energy efficiency and fuel poverty support schemes to £268 million this year, an uplift of £85 million on last year's budget. Across these schemes, we are supporting increasing numbers of zero-emission heating systems.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Clearly, the recent announcement from the International Energy Agency brings forward some of those timetables somewhat, given that they've announced that that gas-fired boilers should be phased out by 2025. So by the end of this point, we need to be well on our way to replacing gas-fired boilers from our homes. But heat pumps cost up to £18,000. And despite the grants, still remain very unaffordable for low- and middle-income households. So can the Cabinet Secretary state whether it would be bringing forward further plans to ensure that this important component transition is affordable for all?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, in short, yes, we will be, and we're continuing to look at the development of technology in this area. The member made direct reference to heat pumps, but of course, heat pumps are only one form of technology which can be used for having domestic heating systems which are net zero, and also for non-domestic properties. So we are continuing to look at the emergence of the new technology as it develops and moves forward to more a wider range of net zero heating systems being available. What I should say to the member is, though, there are a number of issues that we need to take into account here. So some of the standards which apply around this technology are matters which are reserved to the UK Government, and we're working very closely with them to try and agree national standards that allow us to move forward at pace with the standards which will be applied to domestic and non-domestic heating systems. But I can assure the member we're continuing to look at how we can build on the existing arrangements we have in place to help to support people in making this transition.
Supplementary, Liam Kerr.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's draft heat and building strategy states workplaces and homes account for more than a fifth of emissions. I note the Cabinet Secretary's initial answer, but would the Scottish Government also consider our Help to Renovate scheme to support and incentivise improvements in energy efficiency in owner-occupied properties?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we have a range of programmes that we have in place at the present moment, Presiding Officer, so anyone who is looking to install a heating system in their property should look at the schemes which are available, and also the advice which is there free of charge for anyone who is considering installing a new heating system, whether it be through a renovation or whether it be through a new build property. And I would encourage individuals to make use of that scheme to make sure they're using the most up-to-date information on the decisions which they make.
Thank you. Question number two, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure the suitable long-term monitoring and management of Tarbolton Landfill.
Minister Mary McCallum.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to say that the first phase of work has to begin to reduce the environmental and amenity impact of the site will begin later this year. We have agreed to fund this initial work, although the Scottish Government are not responsible for the site. And this is part of a longer journey to remediate the site, and I'm grateful to SEPA for agreeing to commission the work. We will continue to work with our public partners to consider further recommendations from a site investigation for the longer-term restoration of the site.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? I mean, this is something that I've raised in this chamber many times over several years, and it's bounced back across SEPA and the Council and the Scottish Government. And I think the lack of any significant action has resulted in leachate pouring into the local waterways and for gas to blow across local land. It has to fall within the Scottish Government's remit, because it is nobody else's remit, because the site has fallen into disrepair and the people that owned the site are no longer there. So it has to be the Scottish Government. So when will the decisive action taken so the local communities can be rid of this anomaly?
Minister.
Thank the member for the supplementary, and I understand that it's a matter that he has had great concern with over a number of years. I would reassure him that the cooperative working that has led to this initial bit of work being done is to be commended, and I understand that both him and the community and indeed SEPA and the Council will want to see the longer term work take place, and I can assure him that the cooperative working that's gotten us to this point will continue to it will continue to be the way that we approach the longer-term work that everybody acknowledges has to be done.
Question number three, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it will begin and conclude its review of the role of incineration in Scotland's waste hierarchy.
Cabinet Secretary.
Our commitment to tackling the climate emergency and transition to a net zero society by 2045 is unwavering. With this in mind, the Scottish Government is committed to reviewing the role that incineration plays in Scotland's waste hierarchy and are considering options to take forward this review. Parliament will be updated on these plans for this by September this year.
Monica Lennon.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. However, communities like Stonehouse in my region do not have the luxury of time. For the second time, they are fighting proposals for the construction of a large-scale incinerator at Overwood Farm near the former Dovesdale site. They don't want to see the can kicked down the road, Cabinet Secretary. So as part of the forthcoming review, will Government commit to a moratorium until that review can be completed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signed Officer, I am aware of the case and the concerns around this matter. I know that Christina McKelvey, the constituency member, in her constituency capacity, has raised this issue with me over the course of the last few weeks. What I can assure the member of is that we will undertake this review in a very thorough and detailed way in order to ensure that we arrive at the right decision on the role that incineration could play in the future in any waste hierarchy. And that's a process that we need to consider in detail in order to identify the appropriate terms of reference for that review and the timescale under which it will be taken forward. Clearly, any decision on a planning matter is a local issue for the local authority to decide upon, and it's a matter for their process to consider. But what I can assure the member of, as I said in my earlier answer, is that I will update Parliament on this matter in September, once we've had an opportunity to set out the details in much greater detail for the Chamber.
Thank you. Supplementary, Mark Ruskell.
Thanks. I think it's quite clear that we've got a free-for-all for planning applications for incinerators at the moment in Scotland, Cabinet Secretary. So given that in the National Planning Framework there's a moratorium on nuclear power stations and that in the next NPF there will be a ban on fracking, will the Government also consider putting a cap on incineration capacity in NPF 4?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member will be aware that there's work being undertaken at the present moment on NPF 4, and it's important that we do make sure that there is an alignment between our wider strategic approach in government, between reaching net zero, planning and also the waste hierarchy. And it's appropriate that government should look to see how we can ensure that those areas are all coordinated and aligned. And what I can assure the member is that as part of the review which will be undertaken and the wider work which we're undertaking in government, including through the National Planning Framework work which has been undertaken at the moment, we will seek to do that and to achieve that type of balanced approach.
Further supplementary from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thanks for that information, Cabinet Secretary. I'm wondering how quickly the review into incinerators will link up strategy and approach across net zero waste management and planning policies. Decarbonisation of the grid has been so successful that energy from waste technologies can no longer be considered to be low carbon solutions. Does the Minister agree that decisions in future management must be based on the most current and accurate data possible? and that climate change impacts must be minimised to prevent current proposed planning applications for incinerators from having a detrimental impact on achieving our net zero targets.
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises a number of very important issues there, and I want to echo this point about the need to make sure that there is a clear link between our strategy and our approach to net zero waste management and planning policies. As the member will be aware, we are presently conducting a national planning policy review, which has been taken forward and which is due to be published as part of the draft NPF 4 programme in the autumn of this year. And what we want to do is to make sure that the national policy or the national planning framework position statement also is updated by our approach to net zero and waste management. And what we want to do is to make sure we coordinate that across different elements of government. And I can assure the member that that will be part of our thinking and planning as we move forward on this issue.
And if it's very brief, a further supplementary from Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. I just want clarity from the Minister on what he's already been asked is, does he favour a moratorium on new incinerators pending the review that he's announced? I'm not clear what he thinks about that. Should there be one or not?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, for clarity for the member, as I said, I will update Parliament in September on the purpose of the review, and the terms of reference of the review, and the approach we'll take in taking that review forward.
And question number 4, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what progress has been made to address the problem of ice falling from the cables of the Queen's Ferry crossing.
Minister Graeme Day.
Presiding Officer, ice accretion and precipitation centres were installed in the towers and the deck in 2020. Weather forecasting, bridge monitoring and traffic management procedures have been continuously improved, and the mechanism for ice accumulation specific to the Queen's Ferry crossing is now much better understood. A working group comprising Transport Scotland, the bridge operating company Bear Scotland and a number of expert consultants has been established, and a number of possible solutions are currently under consideration in terms of their feasibility.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the Minister for that response, indeed welcome him to his new position. Twice over the last winter, my constituents in Fife and people across the east of Scotland faced huge disruption from the closure of the Queen's Ferry crossing. They don't want to go into another winter seeing a similar situation. It does sound from the Minister's response that any solution, long-term solution, is still some way off. Can he give any comfort or reassurance to my constituents that we won't be facing more winters of disruption?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as members will know, I can't speak for the weather. Weather interventions are beyond our control. What I can offer is some comfort around the extent to which we are getting into this to find solutions. Now, it's worth noting that no similar bridge faced with a similar problem anywhere in the world has identified a single solution to this. But we're getting into this in great detail. Potential options identified are meriting further additional research and development work, and these include cleaning the stay cables, robotics, hydrophobic coatings and de-icing compounds applied to the cables and tower faces. We're also currently designing a system of optical and infrared cameras to be installed in the tower tops, which will focus on the cables and which will help us better understand the mechanism of the ice accreting and falling off the cable stays. There is no shortage of effort or imagination at play in this process. And to further supplement that, I can say to the member, we're also developing a fourth estuary transport model to investigate further improved links between the two bridges, using the old bridge more readily if, in fact, we get into a situation where we need to use that bridge because of circumstances involving ice.
Thank you. Question number 5, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government when it next expects to make an investment announcement for road and rail infrastructure in the south of Scotland.
Again, Minister Graeme Day.
Considering use of potential improvements to all strategic transport infrastructure, including road and rail, across the whole of Scotland, continues to be undertaken through the second Strategic Transport Projects Review, STPR2. This work will create the evidence base for future transport investment decisions by the Scottish Government for the next 20 years. STPR2 will conclude later this year with publication of recommendations for investment and an appropriate statutory consultation period.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the Minister for his response and welcome Graeme Day into his new post. I'd also like to extend an invitation to visit and drive the A75 and A77 and see firsthand how unfit these routes are for the volume of traffic and the type of traffic that use them on a daily basis. With regards to Strategic Transport Project Review 2, Phase 1, it's concerning that no capital investment is contained within the review for the A75 or 77. in the first phase of the study, reinforcing the belief that this corner of Scotland is forgotten, ignored, neglected and deprived. Will the Minister reassure me that he will be the first Minister who constructively works with constituents, businesses and ferry companies to address the increase in the woeful 0.5% of national infrastructure spend currently allocated in the South West, which is holding back economic growth not only here but across Scotland and the rest of the UK, as recognised in the Sir Peter Hendy Union Connectivity Review?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, owing to COVID-19, the STRP2 is coming forward via a two-phase approach. The first, published in February of this year, identified short-term priorities. Phase two will make recommendations to ministers for the longer term under the timetable being worked to. The public consultation and the draft programme, which emerges from this, will launch towards the end of the year. Now, the content of the South West Transport Study, which is fed into the consideration process, contains a number of recommendations. These include targeted improvements to the A77 and A75 and a number of suggested rail packages, including new links between Dumfries and Stranraer and Stranraer and Cairn Ryan. These proposals, along with others, are the subject of detailed consideration.
Supplementary, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Given, Minister, that the Strategic Transport Projects Review, frankly, has been long delayed even before the pandemic, does he actually envisage that we will see major improvement plans actually implemented in the lifetime of this Parliament on neglected roads in the south of Scotland, whether it's the A75 and A77 in the west or the A1 in the east?
Minister.
What I expect, Presiding Officer, is that later this year we will have a set of detailed proposals to consider. This is a 20-year programme designed to deliver for the whole of Scotland, and it will do that.
Further supplementary, Emma Harper, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've written to the Minister regarding infrastructure progress projects around South Scotland, such as the reopening of the Beatwick railway station and upgrading the A75 and A77 as well, which were identified in STPR2 through community consultation with over 2,000 people, unlike the UK Government Union Connectivity Review, which engaged with zero people in South Scotland. Can I therefore press the Minister to provide timescales for the implementation of the STPR2 recommendations, which will improve the lives of people across South Scotland communities?
And to respond in person, the Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I note the chuntering from the Conservative benches at the mention of the Union Connectivity Review. Emma Harper, as they should be aware, knows that transport infrastructure is a matter devolved to the Scottish Government. Therefore, decisions on investment will be taken by the Scottish Government through evidence-based processes, like the Capital Spending Review and the Infrastructure Investment Plan, which allow cross-government decisions on spending to be done in a robust way. The second Strategic Transport Projects Review, rather than the Union Connectivity Review, will be our evidence base to support transport investment decisions that are focused on improving lives, boosting our economy, supporting communities and working towards net zero. I can confirm for Emma Harper that a new station at Beatwick is in the mix, along with changes to the A75 and A77.
Question number six, Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support communities to play their part in achieving Scotland's net zero targets?
Cabinet Secretary.
We've provided over £110 million through our Climate Challenge Fund to enable communities to play their part, and we will continue to support community-led climate action as a key part of our just transition to net zero. We are building on the achievements of the CCF by developing networks of regional community climate action hubs and climate action towns. These initiatives will run alongside the recently launched Net Zero National Campaign, which aims to showcase and inspire climate action across Scotland, including in our communities, using COP26 as a catalyst.
Eleanor Whittam.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. The transition to net zero is going to require every single one of us to play their part, and the CabSec will be aware that investment through the Ayrshire Growth Deal will see Cumnock leading by example with the ambition to become the first carbon neutral town, propelling us onto the world stage. With Scotland centre stage this year with COP26 in Glasgow, can the Cabinet Secretary outline the plans the Scottish Government has to help secure a Glasgow agreement that sees all countries commit to taking the action needed to tackle the climate crisis?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Member raises an important point, and I very much welcome the work that's been taken forward by the Ayrshire Growth Deal Partners, which I was fortunate enough to sign with them on behalf of the Scottish Government, which set out the very ambitious plan for Carmarnock to become a leading example of becoming a carbon neutral town. This fits very much with the approach that the Scottish Government is taking in helping to encourage local communities to play their part in becoming a net zero nation, and also will help to act as a clear demonstration of the leadership that is being taken forward at a community level in Scotland to inspire global leaders as they arrive in Glasgow in November this year for COP26. I can also assure the Member that we will be setting out a range of different measures between now and COP26 on the measures that we will be taking as a country in order to become net zero and to ensure that Scotland continues to be seen as a world leader in this particular area, and that we also not only get the environmental benefits of that but also the economic benefits that come from becoming a net zero nation.
And a brief supplementary, Audrey Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to ensure local employment opportunities, in particular for young people, will be a key part of Scotland's transition to net zero.
Cabinet Secretary.
So, Officer, it's very important to make sure that we not only get the environmental and social benefits of moving to becoming a net zero nation, but we also get the economic benefits of that. And that includes making sure that we're working with partners to deliver the skills which will be necessary to become a net zero nation and to build on the progress we've made to date. That's why, with partners, we're setting up the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, which we have said will be launched in the first 100 days of this government. And we're taking forward progress in developing that, with a key focus on making sure that we look at providing programmes that support retraining and upskilling to make sure that we have a just transition to becoming a net zero nation. That sits alongside a young person guarantee, which also provides young people with environmental-related opportunities to support our national mission of a new, good green jobs recovery.
And James Dornan, who is joining us remotely, question number 7.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and welcome to your new position. To ask the Scottish Government when the last meeting of the Oil and Gas and Energy Transition Strategic Leadership Group was held.
Cabinet Secretary.
At the last meeting of the Oil and Gas and Energy Transition Strategic Leadership Group was held on Thursday, the 18th of February. This was the 9th meeting and chaired by the then Minister for Energy, Connectivity and Islands. The date of the next meeting is as yet to be agreed.
James Dornan.
Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Given the major role that the oil and gas sector, along with its supply chain, has in the Scottish economy and the part it will play in economic recovery from COVID, can the Minister provide an update on any initial plans the sector has in economic recovery, and how does this support the workforce and ensure the energy transition agenda continues to meet our net zero emissions ambition?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, the Scottish Government recognises the crucial role that our oil and gas workers continue to play, not only in maintaining the secure supply of energy to consumers, but also in sustaining critical national infrastructure, as they have done throughout the course of this pandemic. In June last year, the Scottish Government announced some £62 million for the Energy Transition Fund, which has got a key focus on helping to support the energy sector recover from the economic impact of COVID-19, and also to help to support investment in areas which can help to move towards net zero. This work will continue as we move forward, and we will continue to make sure that we engage with the oil and gas sector to ensure that we support it in its transition to moving to becoming a net zero industry. Key to that will be making sure that we help to secure and sustain the skill sets within the workforce, and a key part of the strategy we'll be taking forward is helping to support the sector in making sure that staff or workers within the oil and gas sector have the skill sets necessary to move into the renewable sector and into other green jobs.
Thank you. And the final question, number 8, Pauline McNeill, who again joins us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government plans it has to improve Glasgow's public transport connectivity.
Minister Graham Day.
The Scottish Government is already making significant investment in public transport connectivity in the Glasgow City region. This includes rail enhancements from Glasgow to Barrhera and East Kilbride, and work to reallocate road space on parts of the Glasgow motorway network for buses as part of a £500 million investment in bus priority infrastructure across Scotland. Applications to the bus partnership are being evaluated. Any future Scottish Government investment will be informed by the second Strategic Transport Projects Review, the Phase 1 report recommendations published in February, including the Transforming City scheme, which provides support for a Glasgow Metro.
Pauline McNeill.
The Connecting Glasgow report concluded that Glasgow has a good overall network by British standards, but the city falls substantially short of what has been achieved in similar sized cities in other countries. And with the exception of the 10.5 km Glasgow subway, the entire fixed public transport network is made up heavily of rail lines. And the report says there is an absence of a modern mass transit system serving inner urban destinations is a glaring omission. With that, can the Minister assure me what financial commitments the Scottish Government are making to ensure a modernised rail-based system, as suggested in this report, including a modern air link system, or are they content to leave Scotland's largest city behind?
Minister.
No, we're not. We are considering the case for a Glasgow Metro with a link to Glasgow Airport as part of the STPR and in Phase 1, which identifies the 20 strategic transport investment interventions for the short term. We set out that progression and development of the business case was a government priority. The government supports the council's approach to exploring some of the key challenges of a proposal such as this, and Transport Scotland are working with the council's Glasgow Metro feasibility project team on this. But I hope the member will recognise that a project of the scale of Glasgow Metro requires a strategic business case to ensure taxpayers' money is invested to achieve the best possible outcomes, and that we need to take a whole system approach to planning transport infrastructure to ensure that decisions are taken that benefit the entire region. So conversations with Glasgow City continue, as does this process.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on net zero energy and transport. We move to portfolio rural affairs and islands. And the first question is from Liz Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Cabinet Secretary has had with the Land Reform Minister regarding measures to be put in place to introduce regional land use partnerships.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon.
I'm in regular discussion with the Minister for Environment, Biodiversity and Land Reform, given the close links between our portfolios. We met this week on regional land use partnerships, and stakeholders will be fully engaged as they develop. The Scottish Government remains committed to regional land use partnerships emerging in 2021. They are one mechanism to help maximise the contribution that Scotland's land will make to achieving our climate targets. We announced 5 pilot regions in February to test practicalities around governance, stakeholder engagement and working across regional boundaries. And learning from these pilots will inform any wider rollout of partnerships across Scotland.
Thank you. Liz Smith.
Could I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? On the back of concerns from the NFUS and also for some witnesses who gave evidence to the Environment Committee during the last session of Parliament, I asked the Scottish Government via a written parliamentary question in February this year whether the funding for the regional partnerships would be available via the Rural Affairs Budget, but I was told that it would be the Scottish Government's intention to have the money available from the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform portfolio. Could the Cabinet Secretary confirm whether that is in fact the case, when the money will be available in 2021, and whether it is the Scottish Government's intention to ensure that these schemes become permanent rather than just pilots?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would confirm that that is the case in relation to funding. And again, as I said in my first answer, the objective of the pilots is to test and explore practicalities around governance, local engagement with communities and stakeholders, and working across the regional land use partnership boundaries. Now, we've already provided some resource funding to facilitate the establishment of those pilots this year, and that funding is going to cover the costs of developing governance and facilitating the local engagement and stakeholder meetings that are going to be necessary to establish the pilots this year. And they will also be designed collaboratively by the regions and the Scottish Government, who will provide policy support throughout.
Emma Harper, a very brief supplementary, please.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what steps this Government will take to improve Scotland's system of land ownership and use so that our land can contribute to a fair and just society while balancing public and private interests?
Cabinet Secretary.
This is a vitally important point, and that's where the Scottish Government is absolutely committed to an ongoing and bold land reform, and that has to be continuing and going forward on an ongoing basis. And that's been demonstrated, for example, by the establishment of the Scottish Land Commission and our world-leading land rights and responsibilities statement and the legislation to establish a register of persons with a controlled interest in land to improve the transparency of land ownership in Scotland. And in our manifesto, we've committed to doubling the Scottish Land Fund to £20 million over the lifetime of this Parliament, and as well as taking forward a further land reform bill.
Thank you. Question number two, Liam Kerr.
Sir, to ask the Scottish Government, in light of its announcement regarding a potential cooperation agreement, what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with the Land Reform Minister regarding an assessment of the Scottish Green Party's manifesto commitments on land reform?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would reiterate that I'm in regular discussion with the Minister for Environment, Biodiversity and Land Reform, given the close link between our portfolios. Talks between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Green Party will cover a number of issues, and further updates on those talks will be made in due course. The way in which land is owned, managed and used is centrally important to a variety of outcomes. Everyone has a stake in Scotland's land, and everyone should benefit from Scotland's land. We are committed to a programme of bold land reform, including introducing a new land reform bill and to doubling the Scottish Land Fund to £20 million per year by the end of the Parliament.
Liam Kerr.
Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I hear what she says, but many commentators have suggested the Greens' land proposals are very poorly thought through. For example, rural stakeholders have suggested the plans to introduce land ownership public interest tests and make Scotland's land rights and responsibilities statement statutory are incompatible with human rights legislation. Adopting Green plans would put thousands of rural jobs at risk, including those in the Minister's Angus constituency, and lead to a lack of investment in some of our most remote and fragile environments. So will the Cabinet Secretary rule out adopting these land reform proposals before entering any deal?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's really disappointing to hear the member reiterate these scare stories that go around. And one thing that this government is committed to, as I said, the talks are ongoing, but right now we're committed to delivering what is in our manifesto, our bold ambitions to introduce another land reform bill and doubling the amount that we have available in the Scottish Land Fund. That is our focus and that is what we will deliver.
Question number three, Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to encourage new entrants into farming.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government continues to implement a programme of initiatives to help generational renewal in the agricultural sector. Key initiatives include facilitating land opportunities through its Farming Opportunities for New Entrants group, providing a Scottish land matching service for those considering joint ventures, basic payment scheme entitlements to new and young farmers, delivering a farm advisory service, providing a network of new entrant groups, and offering a free mentoring programme, and supporting partners delivering pilot apprenticeship schemes. And to add to this package, and in line with our manifesto commitment, we will also plan further support through a specific new entrants fund.
Sandesh Gulhani.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. August 2018 saw the government stop the capital grant scheme for new agricultural business. Now, 3 years later, there is no detail or funding. The importance of new entrants and young farmers cannot be overstated, and research published by James Hutton in March 2020 showed these new entrants are notably more active in their intentions for diversification and renewable energy on their land. So with this all in mind, will she commit to reintroducing a fully funded scheme for new entrants to help harness this potential and address the issue of 3 years of missing funds from new entrants?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've already stated in my initial answer to the member, that's exactly what we're looking to do, is to establish a new entrants fund, because I absolutely agree with some of the points that he made and the importance of getting new entrants into farming. And that is why we made that commitment in our manifesto. The previous schemes that he talked about were very successful. And both of those schemes, and particularly the Young Farmer Scheme, were popular. And despite budgets being twice topped up, both closed to new applications in 2018 because the available budgets were exhausted. But that wasn't before they had already supported over 205 young farmers' new businesses and with the associated funding, as well as 49 smaller new enterprises. So the scheme evaluations of that are underway, and that will assist our thinking around planning for a specific new entrant fund included in our manifesto.
Supplementary, Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. Attracting new entrants to farming must be a key long-term priority. So looking ahead to our new support system, can the Cabinet Secretary tell us if any changes are being considered to the reference year payment model in order to ensure that new entrants are not unfairly disadvantaged when it comes to support payments?
Cabinet Secretary.
All of these factors are going to be taken into consideration as we look to develop our new funding schemes.
Question number 4, Katie Clarke.
To ask the Scottish Government what cross-government action it is taking to ensure that island communities are protected from the effects of disruption to lifeline services.
Cabinet Secretary.
I know that ferries are a lifeline service to our island communities and share the frustration at the current disruption and the impact that it's been having. And I've been working with the Transport Minister, who I know has met with senior CalMAC representatives to provide support, as well as meeting with local MSPs to hear their concerns. And the Minister is continuing to have regular dialogue.
Katie Clarke.
The Minister for her answer. A North Ayrshire Council commissioned Fraser of Allender report put the value of the ferry to Arran's community at £170,000 per day, supporting jobs and livelihoods. The Minister has said that a number of meetings have taken place. Would the Minister be willing to meet with me to discuss how the voices of islanders and indeed CalMAC workers are included in the decision-making process to ensure a reliable and safe ferry service, that there is no race to the bottom on terms and conditions, and that support is put in place for Arran's businesses and islanders who are trying to cope at the moment with the disruption?
Cabinet Secretary.
I don't underestimate for one minute the impact that this disruption can have on island communities. And that's why the Minister for Transport was straight to work, and this was one of his top priorities on coming into post, trying to identify solutions and measures that can be put in place over the short, medium and longer term to try and resolve these issues, as well as building resilience within the ferry services that are available. I believe that he had responded during topical questions last week to say that he was willing to engage with any members and to do that on a constructive, work with them constructively on that. And I would reiterate that to the member today.
Okay. Brief supplementary, Jamie Green.
Presiding Officer, more than half of Scotland's ferry network state-operated ferry network is beyond the life expectancy of the original vessels, with 16 out of 31 vessels currently more than 25 years old. The problem is the residents of Arran and many other islands are simply scunnered at the situation. The current ferry network situation is a disgrace in Scotland. Let me ask, how far and wide is the Scottish Government seeking to acquire or lease new vessels right now to offer some temporary relief to our island communities and to the network?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can assure the member that no stone is being left unturned by the Minister for Transport in trying to find resolutions and workable solutions to this. Again, as I mentioned in my previous response, there are short-term measures that are being looked at. I believe that there's an opportunity which is supported by communities that's arisen to charter the MV Pentelina, owned by Pentland Ferries, and that would enable an increase in the size of the major vessel fleet available to CalMAC, supporting the continued operation and increased resilience of lifeline ferry services. There was also news today that the process to build a new ferry for Islay is underway, and the procurement is underway, which again will bring that added resilience to the fleet. And that is also why £580 million is being invested over the next 5 years in the longer term to build that resilience. Because again, I don't underestimate for a moment how frustrating this is for people that live on island communities and just how vital these services are.
All this talk of ferries gladdens my heart, but it's time to move to question 5. Faisal Chowd.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when the Farming and Food Production Future Policy Group will publish its report.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Farming and Food Production Future Policy Group was established as an independent group comprising representatives from the farming and food production sectors to make recommendations around the future of farming food production policy. In addition to environmental and land management representatives who also sat on that body. I held an introductory meeting with the group earlier this week to discuss potential publication.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. The Parliament agreed in January 2019 this group should be set up. 2.5 years on, we have still not seen their conclusion. These delays are symptomatic of the government's indecision and inaction when it comes to setting out the future of post-CAP rural support. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell me when the Scottish Government will set out the details of future support, bringing together the recommendations of this group and the various farmer-led groups?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would completely disagree with the points that have been made by the member there in relation to indecision and inaction. We sought to engage with industry. That is why the farmer-led groups were established. I don't think that members across the chamber would think that that was a bad idea, because I think it's vitally important that we gauge the people who work in these sectors and will be helping to drive these policies forward. We've also had a number of other reports that have been compiled. Farming for 1.5. We have the climate change plan update as well. And the Food and Farm Production Group report will feed into that, as well as those reports of the farmer-led groups. So we have to take all of that information into consideration. And that's also why we set out in the first 100 days of this government that we will establish an implementation board which will drive forward the recommendations of the farmer-led groups and get these policies moving. We don't underestimate the urgency in which this work needs to take place.
Brief supplementary, Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding officer, I totally agree with Faisal Chowdhury. It's indecision and inaction of this government. NFU's Andrew McCormack said in February, give Scottish agriculture a policy roadmap now. Months later, there's no plan. It's totally ridiculous. Cabinet Secretary, no more excuses. Where is Scotland's future farm policy document? How much longer will Scottish farmers have to wait? And why is
Cabinet
the SNP
Secretary.
Disadvantaging Scottish farmers?
I would simply ask the member if she would prefer that we didn't engage with the farmer-led groups and establish them in the way that we did. It is important that we get those recommendations, and that's exactly why we've said we will move that forward within our first 100 days in government and build an implementation board that will drive those recommendations forward.
Question number six, Colette Stevenson, who joins us, I think, remotely.
Hi. To ask the Scottish Government what action it will take to support businesses in East Kilbride working in the food and drink sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
We have committed support of over £10 million over 2020 to 2022 towards the food and drink sector's COVID-19 recovery plan, which contains 50 actions to help businesses across Scotland recover from COVID-19 and the disruptions of Brexit. This includes our 100 days commitment to publish a local food strategy and provide grants from the Regional Food Fund to support local and regional food festivals and initiatives. South Lanarkshire Council has also paid out over £1.2 million to businesses through the Local Authority Discretionary Fund, which empowers local authorities to direct funding to specific groups or sectors affected by COVID-19.
Colette Stevenson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I would be interested to know whether the Clyde Climate Forest will present an opportunity for the many qualified recreational deer managers in the Central Belt. And does the Scottish Government believe there is a need to support the establishment of fit-for-purpose processing facilities to use the venison locally?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Clyde Climate Forest is a really significant and well-timed initiative, showcasing all that's good about tree planting, and including a partnership arrangement with 8 local authorities working together on a major woodland creation initiative. Sustainable deer management is key to the success of woodland creation, and recreational deer managers play a vital role in delivering that. And as we recognise the importance of processing facilities for venison to support deer management and local supply chains, we're working with the Scottish Venison Association on possible options to support processing in areas where those facilities might be limited.
Thank you. Question number 7, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its key priorities are for Scotland's island communities.
Cabinet Secretary.
As detailed in the SNP manifesto, the Scottish Government is committed to delivering a number of priorities for Scotland's island communities, including, for example, the New Islands Programme, which will invest £30 million of capital funding over the next 5 years to support delivery of the National Islands Plan.
Dean Lockhart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Interestingly, the Cabinet Secretary didn't mention connectivity. In recent months, residents and small businesses across Scotland's island communities have lost millions of pounds because of disruption to multiple ferry services because they're operating beyond their scheduled service lives, as my colleague Jamie Green highlighted earlier. 2 new replacement ferries, which were meant to service the islands, remain unfinished on the Clyde, more than £200 million over budget and more than 3 years late, with no prospect of being in service any time soon. Will the Cabinet Secretary take this opportunity to apologise to island communities for this massive disruption? And what assurances can she give today that this massive level of disruption will not continue into the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've outlined in responses to previous questions relating to ferries this afternoon, the Scottish Government absolutely recognises the frustration of communities at the disruption, and we recognise the impact that that is having. And that is why, as I've reiterated, we're doing everything we possibly can to try and build resilience within the fleet and to try and mitigate against some of those problems, and supporting CalMAC to maximise available capacity across the network and to ensure that there is timely resolution of these issues. And we're also delivering new tonnage to support communities, working with CMAL, CalMAC, MSPs, community representatives and others to develop investment programmes for major vessels and small vessels. And as I said previously, that amounts to an investment of over £580 million over the course of the next 5 years.
I'm going to try to get supplementaries in, but they do need to be brief as to the responses. Firstly, Beatrice Wisher.
I've called for an island-proof recovery before. Will the Cabinet Secretary commit to timely guidance for the islands for life at level zero and beyond?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes.
Commendably brief. I'll call Ariane Burgess, please.
To ask the Minister how the Scottish Government will support Orkney Islands Council in its efforts to ensure that the people of the Orkney Islands will be able to fully benefit from the island's renewable potential.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm more than happy to engage with Orkney Islands Council on that. I hope to be visiting Orkney at some point soon, in line with the restrictions, but I hope to be able to have those conversations.
But I allowed these supplementaries in. And Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government have failed our island communities. They've failed to provide the new ferries required, but they've also failed to maintain that the ones that they have, which has led to this current fiasco. At a time when capacity is 35% of what would be normal, will she commit to leasing the Pentolina, buying the ferry identified by the Mull community, and identifying further tonnage that will meet demand and create the capacity required in our islands?
Cabinet Secretary.
This is work that the Transport Minister, he set straight to work on that as soon as he was appointed. And I've outlined repeatedly this afternoon and the number of measures that are being undertaken to do exactly what the member has just outlined. The measures that we're looking to introduce in the shorter term to build that resilience in relation to ongoing investment. So I would just really reiterate to the member that this is a big priority for this government. It's a big priority for the Transport Minister, who's gone straight to work on addressing these issues.
Question number 8, Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it will take in response to reports of Danish and Swedish boats intensively fishing for sand eels off the Firth of Forth.
Cabinet Secretary.
The terms of the Trade and Cooperation Agreement established between the UK and EU in December 2020 entitles these vessels access to fish their quota in UK waters. Through the bilateral agreement for 2021, finalised last week, total allowable catch level has been set for sand eel, which gives the EU quota to fish against. However, given the importance of sand eel to the wider ecosystem and the subsequent benefit in aiding the long-term sustainability and resilience of the North Sea, it remains an overarching and long-held Scottish Government position to not support fishing for sand eel or other industrial species in our waters. As such, I've instructed my officials to consider what management measures can be put in place to manage activity in the most sustainable way possible.
Willie Rennie.
Well, that's very good news. The Kittiwake population has been cut in half in the last 50 years, in part as a result of industrial sand eel fishing. In the last month, over 20 Swedish and Danish boats spent days off the Fife coast hoovering up tons of sand eels for pigmeal. Local fishermen and the RSPB are very concerned about the impact on seabirds. A previous government took action at Wee Bankie. I think we need action now. I want the Minister to think of the puffins and set out urgent action on sand eels today.
Cabinet Secretary.
Oh, absolutely, and I appreciate the concerns that have been raised by Willie Rennie today, and completely understand the concern regarding sand eels, because of course it is about the wider ecosystem and the impact that that has on species whose numbers are depleting. So that is why I have committed, and I hope that he takes that assurance, that we will be looking at this as a matter of urgency to see what measures we can potentially put in place.
Thank you very much. That concludes portfolio questions. There will be a slight pause in business. There will be change. Presiding officers.